Hey, good afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you, thank you. Welcome to this afternoon's panel, which is called Dispelling the Myth of a Post-Racial America. It's a pleasure to be the moderator. I'm Kim Taylor Thompson. I'm a professor here. And I'm hoping that you're going to find this conversation stimulating and thought-provoking, because the topic certainly engenders that kind of reaction, a lot of heated and wide-ranging views on this one. So the question is, have we entered a post-racial America? If we look back a couple of years to when President Obama was elected, there was a lot of euphoria around the election, and it led a lot of people to proclaim that we actually had reached a turning point in race relations, that divisions had narrowed, people argued, and America had somehow now become post-racial. And in many ways, those views were confirmed or reinforced by President Obama's own style, through his style of campaigning and through his silence on racial issues. A lot of people tended to be encouraged in the view that perhaps we had entered into a new era, a post-racial era. But have we? In the midst of some progress that we're experiencing, a number of people remain unconvinced that we've entered into a post-racial America and are unconvinced that America's racial problems and racial divides are somehow in the rearview mirror. Despite improvements in race relations in the country, we still see a criminal justice system that is disproportionately incarcerating African Americans and Latino males. We have an education system that perpetuates an achievement gap that really tends to track racial lines. We still have poverty that is largely racialized. And as we get a better handle on the impact of the latest recession, we know that a majority of Americans have suffered in this, but people of color still bear the brunt of economic hardship. If we look at the unemployment rate, we see that African Americans have an unemployment rate of 1.5 to 2 times greater than that of whites. African Americans have been disproportionately affected by market failures in home financing. More than half of the subprime loans went to people of color. So as a doctrine of post-racialism seems to be gaining some traction, there are some who worry that it may silence conversations about race and about racial disparities that still need to take place. So that's the context. That's what brings us here, okay? And if you turn on the TV at night, maybe Fox News or something like that, you're going to see this issue debated in a probably wilder way than it'll be debated today. But I suspect that those conversations tend to lack the kind of intellectual rigor and intelligence that I hope we will bring to the conversation today. So let me introduce our panelists. To my immediate right, we have Professor Rick Banks. Professor Banks is the Jackson Eli Reynolds Professor of Law at Stanford, and he is a professor at the School of Education at Stanford as well. He has been a member of the Stanford faculty since 1998. He began teaching at age 2.
Yes.
I thought he'd like that. And he teaches and writes about family law, employment discrimination law, and race in the law. And he is an author and has a book that is currently on the market. It's called Is Marriage for White People? How the African-American Marriage Decline Affects Everyone. Very provocative. To my left, we have Professor Sumi Cho. Professor Cho is a professor of law at DePaul University College of Law. She employs a critical race feminist approach to her work on affirmative action, sexual harassment, legal history, and civil rights. She was the principal investigator for a civil liberties public education fund grant on the first coordinated legal research on Japanese American internment, redress, and reparations. She teaches critical race theory and employment discrimination and has published widely. A couple of her articles, I'm going to give you a couple of titles. Converging Stereotypes in Racialized Sexual Harassment, Where the Model Minority Meets Suzy Wong. Korean Americans versus African Americans, Conflict and Construction. And she's written an article on post-racialism. And then finally, but not least, we have our own Professor Paulette Caldwell. She's a professor of law here at NYU, and she is a recognized critical race scholar. Among her publications, she has written The Content of Our Characterizations, Dreadheads, Roles, Models, and the Black Voice in Mainstream News. and a hairpiece, Perspectives on the Intersection of Race and Gender. Now, those of you who have had the benefit of being in her classroom know that she is a phenomenal teacher, and she teaches in the area of critical race, employment discrimination, race, and legal scholarship. And please join me in welcoming our entire panel. So a moment on format. The plan is to give each of our panelists an opportunity to address as an opening question whether they think we've entered a post-racial era in America. And they have been told that they have about 3 to 5 minutes and that they will be yanked off the microphone at 5 minutes, so they're nervous. And then after they've had 5 minutes or so to talk, what we will do is I will engage in a couple of questions, ask them some questions that occur to me, and then I'm going to open this up as quickly as possible to get your take on any of these questions so that you can jump into the fray. So does that sound okay? Oh, nodding bobbleheads out there. I like it. All right. So we're going to start with Professor Cho, and please take it away.
Well, thanks so much to, in particular, Vice Dean Jeannie Forrest, our moderator, Professor Kim Taylor Thompson, and as well my co-panelists and the students, in particular, Aisha Dennis, for organizing this conversation. So I wanted to share with you some of my thinking. I did write an article, my recent thinking after my post-racialism article, but let me first start out by in order to answer the very good question, you know, are we in a post-racial era? Everybody seems to perhaps have a different definition of what post-racialism is. So I'm going to share with you my definition from my Iowa Law Review article. And to me, post-racialism is not like a set of facts or events or happenings, but rather it represents a 21st century ideology that refers to symbolic progress to suggest that the state no longer needs to adopt racial remedies and civil society no longer needs race as a central organizing principle. And there are 4 central features of post-racialism that I identified in the Iowa Law Review that include racial transcendence, you know, like Obama's election in 2008, that we've transcended the racial moment, race-neutral universalism, that we can no longer talk specifically about race as a collective identity and need to pursue more universalistic policies, a sort of moral equivalence, you know, that those who criticize racism are the same as those who enact racism, and a distancing move, that is to say that the old way of doing business in terms of the civil rights and collective political subjectivities is being replaced by the sort of New Jack City mode of black politics today. And, you know, they will often have articles listing, you know, a number of these politicians, including Obama. So my follow-up work on that is tentatively entitled The Moral Economy of Post-Racialism. And I'm really starting with 3 orienting questions to approach this work. First, how does the racial project of whiteness in the age of Obama compare and contrast with the project post the immediate era prior to it, you know, the post-World War II era through his election? Second, how is post-racial whiteness able to remain a valuable asset in society while simultaneously conveying that race doesn't matter anymore? And third, what conceptual, discursive, and representational mechanisms are deployed in law and society to perform this seeming contradiction, right? That it still retains value, but it doesn't matter. And in order to answer that, I was really struck by this work by, I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, Donna Shabilowitz and Abdul John Muhammad, critical scholars and humanists who use the concept of moral capital to understand how the politics of morality are deployed for structural and material advantage. They were writing at the time of the first Gulf War, and in short, they argue that moral value is extracted through the deft deployment of discursive and cultural representations that are then transformed and reaccumulated as moral capital and eventually recirculated and reinvested to transfer material value. And they, you know, refer to these T-shirts that would say U.S. 1, Saddam 0. The moral economy is accumulates material value in this way for both simple consumption, you know, as a direct exchange in the form of taxes extracted from the American public to finance war, in return for a sense of self-righteousness, or let's say Du Bois's notion of a psychological wage that lines up on the side of freedom, justice, and good. This moral capital often accumulates without explicit public articulation. And so I was using that concept and notion to think about how moral capital is a particularly important resource in the era of racial hegemony versus racial domination. Okay, great. So this current work, and I think I only have time to share with you some images of this, but I'm basically arguing that although much has been written about the transcendence of race in the era of post-racialism that we allegedly now inhabit, the depiction of the U.S. as a post-racial society should be understood to be a particular kind of racial project that seeks to silence, defame, and appropriate blackness, because such a project is necessary to redeem whiteness morally to recover its pre-Jim Crow value in a post-civil rights, post-racial era. And there's three essential strategies to the moral economy of post-racialism: silencing blackness, defaming blackness, and appropriating blackness, which in terms of, I'm gonna concentrate on defaming blackness, you know, seeks to rearticulate the meaning of civil rights and Dr. King using popular depiction of how African-Americans in particular are morally bankrupt. We saw this quite acutely, you know, with the Acorn hoax brought to you by Andrew Breitbart, which affected a sort of drive-by defamation. Acorn, as you know, was targeted a successful nonprofit with a history of registering millions of low-income African-American voters. And eventually, although Acorn was ultimately cleared of any wrongdoing in multiple investigations, nonetheless, much of the country believes that the now defunct organization supported prostitution, engaged in voter fraud, and caused the subprime lending crisis. You should also, and they were eventually defunded by Congress, as you know. Secondarily, more recently, you remember the Shirley Sherrod incident. Now, that hoax did unravel when Farmer Spooner stepped up and defended Shirley Sherrod, and the very clear cut-and-paste editing was obvious. And there was an ultimate media backlash against both Breitbart and the Obama administration. And then finally, in terms of appropriating blackness, you just compare, for example, in the transfer of surplus moral capital from the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. And if you could see the signs, you know, talking about justice and fair wages and fair treatment, good schools, and you can see, you know, for whom, to the 2009 Glenn Beck March on Washington, basically advocating policies that would benefit the 1% of America. I don't have time to go into how, as a comparative, you know, if you think about also the imagery that's coming out with regards to immigration, there are similar but somewhat distinct things going on in which immigrants are shown to be invaders or proliferating horde, with a high degree of sort of dog whistle post-racialism going on, as well as countering resistance. But I'll just leave you with Derek Bell's, you know, words for us, you know, not to forget the resistance part. You know, as a matter of faith, we believe, despite the lack of linear progress, there is satisfaction in the struggle itself. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Caldwell.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Aisha Dennis and Color, for bringing us together today. I really appreciate Professor Cho's comments about multiple definitions of post-racialism. So I'm going to offer another definition that overlaps somewhat the one she gave, but that gives us another insight. Post-racialism invites us to reconcile the tension between our sense of ourselves as a nation built on racial equality and enormous race-based disparities that continue and that are deepening. It defines racism only in terms of invidious intent, and then it tells us that racial minorities are no longer subject to systemic discrimination, that that kind of racism is over, and therefore discrimination does not exist. And since minorities are no longer subject to that discrimination, post-racialism rejects race-conscious remedies as a grant of benefits to minorities at the cost of whites, and those remedies are themselves create racial inequality. And finally, that since racial minorities are no longer subject to invidious discrimination, any remaining disadvantages they experience are their own fault, reflect their own inadequacies and own problems. Now, post-racialism obviously masks, one of its purposes is to mask continuing racial inequality. But I think it does something else. It transcends it. Professor Cho said she wanted to speak about racial transcendence in the election of Professor Obama. President Barack Obama. But it transcends racism in a different way, a more specific way. It normalizes racial inequality, legitimizes them, prepares us to accept them as permanent and inevitable. Now, many post-racialists think we ought to focus only on neutral rules and practices and everything that deals with social welfare in the society. And I want to just leave you with two points. Segregation, which is a principal manifestation of racism, is a structured and structuring phenomenon. Once it's set into motion, it no longer needs a moving hand to perpetuate itself. It will perpetuate itself into infinity unless it's affirmatively interrupted. So looking today for intent in a society that buries intent, law doesn't recognize intent unless it's very, very obvious and direct or proven, hard to prove, excuse me, that what we have now are the continuing effects of a system of segregation, and we're still trying to work that out. Now let's think what happens if we superimpose neutral rules on top of an underlying system of inequality. We're going to continue to perpetuate inequality, and in many instances, we're going to exacerbate it.
Thank you, Professor Caldwell. Professor Banks.
So my wife tells me I can never stick to the time limit, so I'm going to try to stick to the time limit by setting my timer. So I got on 5 minutes. So it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you to my co-panelists, Professor Caldwell and Professor Cho, for such a stimulating dialogue. Thank you, all of you, for coming. Also to Milbank Tweed for sponsoring this event. You know, my interest in law, I guess I decided that I wanted to go to law school when I realized that I was interested in language and in the ambiguity of language and the multiplicity of meanings that words carry. And I think this is what I see with the term post-racial as well, right? This is a term that sort of begs for a definition, and it's also open to many different definitions. So my answer to the question of are we post-racial is sort of, well, it depends, which is often the lawyerly answer. It depends, right? In one sense, the answer is yes, right? We are post-racial if we mean by post-racial that we have disavowed what had been for many generations the official ideology of the United States, which was one of racism. There was an official ideology of racism in the United States, which we have disavowed, and this is fairly recently. And one marker of this, which I always find telling, is that, you know, prior to the 1930s, in fact, there was no term racism. The term racism did not exist. It had not been invented until, as my colleague reminds, Hitler gave racism a bad name. Mm-hmm. And when Hitler gave racism a bad name, the term racism came into existence as a critique of what had been previously accepted as the way things were. The idea that there were deep and ineradicable differences between blacks and whites, that there was a racial hierarchy with some groups superior, other groups inferior, that was so taken for granted that there was no critique. There was no designation of that as racism. It was just the way things were. So I think that's real progress that we have rejected that official ideology. But then in another sense, of course, we're not post-racial. If by post-racial you mean that race is no longer a factor in American society and it's no longer culturally significant. Quite the opposite, right? Race remains culturally significant, freighted with all sorts of meanings and stereotypes and associations. It also remains socially significant. It is still very much the case that society socially is structured along lines of race, and this is true whether we look at friendship groups and housing or employment or criminal justice or education and all domains of life. We almost can't understand what's happening in those areas without thinking about race. So pervasive is race in our society. So we're not post-racial in that sense. So the bind that we have, I think the bind that we're in, is that people genuinely do want to be colorblind. And I think that's a positive thing. They genuinely do want to be colorblind. They want not to see race. But the tragedy is that they can't realize it. We can't realize that aspiration because race remains so pervasively significant, right? So in any domain, we can talk criminal justice, education, politics, one might have an aspiration toward colorblindness, but you can't realize it because in practice, race is so socially significant, you would be missing a lot. to not look at race, and in fact, you can't not look at race. You can't not pay attention to it. So, and it's difficult to recognize both aspects of the spine, right? Conservatives ignore the fact that race is pervasively significant. Liberals, I think, often ignore the fact that it is real progress for us to aspire to colorblindness and to not evaluate people based on the color of their skin rather than the content of their character. We see the evasion of the spine in the legal doctrine as well. Anti-discrimination doctrine continues to be premised on the idea, as Professor Caldwell suggested, that we need to engage in a search for the racist, right? We need to find the bigoted decision maker, right? The person who made the biased decision. Anti-discrimination doctrine is much less attentive to and much less capable of dealing with this much more diffuse constellation of meanings and inequalities that are associated with race, right? It's really kind of a culture and a society that we have to remake. And that's the challenge. And then the question is, well, who can execute that challenge? Who can make good on that, the promise of America here? As lawyers, we tend to think that the job should fall to courts, right? And I, for years, thought the job should fall to courts, right? Courts are the ones who enforce rights. Courts are the ones who implement visions of equality. But if we think of racial problems, this diffuse constellation of meanings and this, I'm going to take my 10 more seconds. Okay.
10 more seconds.
If we think, this will be my last long sentence here. Right? Okay. A lot of commas and a lot of punctuation. But no, so if we think of race as this, you know, this set of big social problems, right, that are you know, not about individual decision makers making biased decisions, then we might question whether courts are really the ones to solve these problems. Because the solving the problem does require, and I'll just use this term, social engineering, right? It requires the very sorts of social engineering that are indeed in tension with widely held ideas about the limits of the judicial role. Right? So there's a role for courts, but many of our problems, perhaps, are not the sort of problems that we can exclusively put in the domain of courts. There has to be room for social action. There has to be room for political action. There has to be room for very pragmatic problem solving that recognizes that we have lots of inequalities that persist, but they are less frequently now than any time in our past the result of individual biased decision makers. Who've made bad decisions. So we will leave it there.
Okay. Wow. Wow, I'm not sure where to begin. but let's start with just a general question. I love the conversation about the various definitions. And I suspect that depending on your perspective, you may define it differently. Mm-hmm. But who is looking to advance the post-racial message? Who's looking to do it? Who benefits from it? Who wants to play?
I'll start. I think that's an excellent question and one that I had to think very hard about. And I don't think that, let's say, ideological conservatives per se have a lot bound up in the term post-racialism. In many ways, colorblindness was working fine, right? And so what I try to argue in the Iowa Law Review is that I think post-racialism represents a sort of rebranding that serves the interests of, let's say, more ideological liberals to make more current and less problematic a lot of the package that goes along with colorblindness that especially young folks don't want to sign up for, right? And so post-racialism gives you a little bit more hip and modern type of, you know, location, let's say, than colorblindness.
Rick, do you want
to? Okay, I think I'm on board with that. No, I think the I think the question is you know, what do we mean by post-racialism?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the question, and I think that there
who benefits from sort of getting that message out there that there is this notion, however you define it.
Well, I think as Americans, American society, we are especially inclined to want to congratulate ourselves for progress, right? And
even when there is none.
You know? Well, I mean, we want to, right? We want to do that, right? And we look for that. And I think that's not a bad thing, right? Because, you know, so my parents grew up, I'll just get personal for a moment. So my parents grew up in Alabama and Georgia. Right, and they're both deceased now, right? So, but they grew up in a time when they could not have imagined this panel. You know, they could not have imagined all the things that my children will take for granted in terms of the opportunities that are open for them. And that is real progress, right? And so I think that it's fine for people to recognize that progress, to acknowledge that progress, and to say, and you can say with honestly that, I mean, this is an extraordinarily racially diverse nation, and in many ways, we have done what no other nation in the world has done. And that's worthy of celebration. But that need not negate the fact that there are glaring disparities and inequalities in practically every domain of life, right? Yeah. Health and well-being, my book looks at marriage and intimate relationships, child rearing, education, criminal justice, you go down the list. Right? You, in fact, it's difficult to find an area where race is not salient. That's how pervasive race is, right? But I think we can both recognize the progress and also recognize that there's still work to be done, even as the challenges, in some sense, are different than the challenges of 40 or 50 years ago.
So if race does permeate everything from every kind of relationship, all of these institutions that Rick is just talking about, Paulette, what do you think about this notion of this post-racial framework? Is it being used to, in some ways, mask how race is permeating those institutions, or is it being used in some way to help us think about it in a different way?
I think there are a couple of ways to think about it. I was thinking about flipping your question.
Flip away.
When you said, who benefits? Now, first occurred to me that the media benefits was all over. The press, all over the broadcast media, that we're in a post-racial society because of the election of President Obama. But that would just be flippant. When I think about benefits, when I want to flip your question is to ask who's burdened. And I think the burden question is more important to me in this sense. Yes, race permeates all of the areas that Professor Banks spoke about. But when we speak of law and public policy, we are narrowing the areas that we are considering. And so a post-racial narrative in law and public policy is bothersome to me in the sense that it suggests that we do nothing about continuing inequalities. It's a a reference back to benign neglect. Just let it happen, that the differences that exist will always exist. It almost harkens me back to Justice Harlan's dissent in Plessy. Justice Harlan calls for a colorblind society. If you ever sit in my class, I'm going to bore you with the beginning of that paragraph. Because nobody ever looks in law school at the beginning of the paragraph in which Justice Harlan's dissent speaks of a colorblind constitution. It is used always to say that what has happened is that we have flipped, that now what was the majority opinion in Plessy is now the dissent. And as a society, we have transcended separate but equal, that sort of kind of racism that Professor Banks spoke about, and now we are a colorblind society. But if you read the beginning of that dissent, it says, this is a white country, white people are superior, that will always be the case, but our Constitution is colorblind. So he was speaking of something very, very different that I think you and I are speaking about. Right? So when we talk about who is burdened by a policy perspective and a legal perspective that says we have transcended race, there is nothing we can do about it, we are asked to accept the beginning of Justice Harlan's paragraph for the 21st century, and I'm not quite willing to do that. Now, since somebody invoked Professor Bell, I think it's also important for us to remember Professor Bell told us always to look at those faces at the bottom of the well, and they are bearing this burden of social inequality more than anybody else in the society. And it's extremely important for us to do that. And as a society, I love my country. To tell me that my country is the only one that has done progress in racial equality, most in progress than any other nation, bothers me because I see my nation slipping. I don't want to live in a nation that normalizes an underclass in education, in housing, in wealth, in every important aspect of social benefit that criminalizes and then requires those people to carry the collateral consequences of mass incarceration and imprisonment. I don't want to live in that society. I want to celebrate that society. I don't think we've moved far enough for me to be that celebratory. It's my country. I want us to move forward from where we are now.
Let's open it up.
Can I just respond?
You can.
Well, I mean,
it's coming in 1 second, but Professor Banks.
Yeah, I agree with most. I guess I would just say, I mean, a question I'm writing down for myself is, does our aspiration to colorblindness, right, and to equality, does that aspiration impede progress, or can it facilitate progress, right? Now, it can impede progress, right, if people lapse into thinking, oh, we've elected a black president, all that racial stuff now we can put behind us, right? So that can happen. But can't we also harness that aspiration to facilitate progress? I mean, for example, we could imagine, right, someone you could take, I mean, I think of my neighbors or friends who are not academics, who, you know, if I ask them, I say, look, we walk into a hospital and we see black kids and white kids and Latinos and Asians in the hospital, and we say, you know, can we predict what's going to happen to these children based on their race? I mean, at birth, right, can we make a pretty good guess about who's going to end up where? And in fact, we can, right? Their opportunities are not equal. And then if you ask someone, is that fair? Is that the society we want? I think most people would say no, right? And you can draw on their aspiration to conclude that the answer should be no. We should not have a society where opportunities are distributed so unequally along racial lines, right? So I think the challenge really is to try to harness the commitment to colorblindness, even colorblindness, post-racialism, anti-discrimination, equality, try to harness all that so that people can see that social programs that advance the situation of African-Americans and other minorities, that those social programs are consistent with their ideals, right? And that's, I think, the only way we're going to make progress.
I agree.
Okay, we're going to open it up. Lots of hands. Okay, I actually
had... Just ask Professor Banks one question before you...
I'm not going to get to you.
Okay, he said to call him Rick. He'll call me Paulette. I want to know, I love that, and of course we want to build on our aspiration to colorblindness and to post-racialism. It's, of course, an appropriate aspiration. I want to know how truthful we can be with our neighbors.
Well, I think I'll tell you.
Let me just ask the question. I want to know. This is what I'm concerned about. And this is not just cross race lines. It's class lines. It includes everybody in this room. We didn't tell people after Brown, the beginning of the second Reconstruction around race in this country. We did not tell them. In order to have a colorblind society, in order to get beyond the society that we had in the Jim Crow era, between the first Reconstruction and Jim Crow, that somebody was going to have to give up something. Brown was heuristic. We can have equality, and nobody has to give up anything. I'm finding it hard to get past the idea that racial justice is plainly redistributive. It has to be at some level. Certainly, even when we were in very, very good times in the civil rights legislation period, when everybody was working, when the society was expanding, it wasn't even possible then to justify or to provide a larger portion of that expanding pie to racial minorities. We're in a very, very different economic situation now, and that's what's frightening to me. I want to know whether or not we have to admit to ourselves that somebody has to give up something, including us.
You want me to answer that? Let me answer really quickly. So
very quickly,
I'll just say there are. Let me talk about this without regard to race,
okay.
Right? So without regard to race, you know, our society has become more unequal over the. This is why Occupy Wall Street is a timely movement, right? Our society has become more unequal over the past many decades, more unequal than other industrialized nations. That's a problem. Right? So we need to actually make a case for redistribution. Before race even enters into it, we need to make a case for redistribution. Right? And the case for redistribution is, in essence, that, you know, if we don't have a more fair society, if we tolerate these gross disparities in opportunity and income and so forth, we're going to imperil all of our future. Right? Because even if you're in the 1%, you know, you're not, your society is eventually going to crumble if we don't do something to check the excesses. So we have to do that, and we need to make that apparent to people that redistribution actually serves all of our interests, right? And I'll say, I mean, I'm happy to pay more taxes. And we should, right? I mean, this population, right, as you all move on to the workforce, we should all pay more taxes, right? And so we should make that happen.
Adding the racial lens?
And in terms of race, though, I will say that race is, you know, I don't know if my wife wants to pay more taxes, because we're trying to get our backyard redone now. But, you know, but we're willing to do that.
And this is being taped and will be on the internet.
But, you know, in terms of race, again, I mean, there are many examples. Let's take the example of education, right? So African-Americans and Latinos particularly, and black boys in particular, and these are some of the issues that I actually discuss in my book, in the forthcoming book as well, that, you know, these groups are struggling. And these groups are struggling to such an extent that our competitiveness as a nation is undermined. And we're here together. Right? So the problems that result from the underachievement and over-incarceration of African Americans and Latinos, they are not problems that will be confined to those groups. Once again, those are problems that will imperil the future of our nation for everyone. So one would do well to recognize that our fates are linked, and our nation can only thrive if we create a setting where everyone in our nation is going to be able to be competitive and productive so that we can compete with these other nations, right? And I think that's, when you make that case to people, again, I think people are ultimately well-intentioned. I think if we could make that case to people, we find lots of open minds, right? But we need to make that case and we need to keep making it because people just don't understand how pervasive inequality is and how pervasive racial inequality actually undermines all of our opportunities in the long run.
All right, let's open it up. I actually had a question way in the back before. Did I lose the person? Gone. Okay. No, there she is. She popped up like a piece of toast. There she is. Okay.
That's great.
Very So I have a question that might have been answered at some point, but I think that as I listened to you, I was wondering what role does the concept of class plays in the analysis of the racial problem? Because it seems to me that you can't really separate them when you're talking about social justice or injustice.
So what role does class play? Who wants to take it?
Well, just when we were talking about aspirations, let me just first say that maybe I'm the outlier, but I don't aspire to either color blindness or post-racialism. And in terms of redistribution, I guess the way I'm thinking about that is, I think we tend to think, as classical economists do, that redistribution represents an intervention into the market. But I guess what critical race theory is attempting to do is to say that distribution was always already an intervention through the state and through the law, mediated mm-hmm. through mm-hmm. race, gender, class, mm-hmm. Sexuality, et cetera. Yes. Yeah. And I do think that class is fundamentally a part of the critical project. And that when you look back to the struggles, for quality education, access, housing, employment, right? 1963, the janitor strike, et cetera, fundamentally about class. I think what has happened is that somehow, in the name of pragmatism, many civil rights advocates have been forced into smaller and smaller terrain by virtue of the logic of constitutionally mandated narrow tailoring of remedies. Mm. So we're into this tiny piece, which we now see most prominently as affirmative action, which is clearly very class tilted, right? Which seems to erase, the commonalities, and the overlap that we share, for economic justice. So I think that that's a very good question, and so that we can't allow the current strictures to limit our imagination or our ability to get involved in things like Occupy Wall Street.
Okay, we had a question over here. Yeah. Go ahead. It's coming.
So one of the terms that's bounced around is this term of colorblindness, mm-hmm. and I would suggest that in the same way, post-racial begs the question, what mm-hmm. is that? So too does colorblindness. And there seems to be some disagreement about what that term means and whether it really should be an aspirational goal and what it might give us as a goal, and I was hoping you could talk about that a little bit.
It's interesting. I'd written down a question that I was going to ask, which I showed assuming it was right. Exactly that question. Yep. So I think you were peeking up here. Paulette, do you want
to
start?
I'm going to point to Rick Banks.
Rick first?
Let's be clear. Well, I teach your piece that speaks to this issue my critical race theory class. So I want to hear you expound. I want to hear your reflection on your own work.
And now I'm feeling bad because I didn't even do the reading.
No, you didn't.
I think you're right that the term colorblindness, whenever I hear the term colorblindness, of course, I'm perplexed because there are multiple meanings, right? We could mean by colorblindness that the law should enforce non-discrimination, right? We could mean that. We could mean by colorblindness that people should act as though race doesn't matter in their daily life, that they shouldn't have a racial identity, that they should be people first and not members of racial groups or understand themselves in that way. By colorblindness, we could mean a society in which race is not associated with the distributions of burdens and benefits, right? In which someone's location in the social structure is not dependent on or intertwined with their race, right? And we have all these different meanings. So you know, I think it would be better, frankly, if we could talk about colorblindness one, colorblindness two, and colorblindness three, right? If we could be clear what we're talking about. And the idea that the law should enforce non-discrimination, you know, many people use the colorblindness in that way, and that's a complicated question. I mean, I think sometimes yes and sometimes no, right? The law should enforce non-discrimination. I think that question becomes less important, though, if we spend less time, if we stop assuming that all sorts of racial conflicts and political conflicts need to go through the courts, right? That the court should be the first and final arbiter of racial controversies. The idea that colorblindness as the idea that one should not have a racial identity, people have different views on that, and that's fine. I think there are people for whom racial identity is very important. There are people for whom it's less important. I think racial identity shifts across time. My identity is different from my parents because I was raised in Cleveland, they were raised in the Deep South, and my kids are raised in San Francisco. So we're all gonna have very different racial identities, even though we're all African-American, and that's fine. And then finally, the idea of colorblindness as signifying that life in the United States is not color-coded, right? And that people's place in the social structure does not depend on race. I think that's the aspect of colorblindness that is truly desirable, right? And that's the idea that I think we should push, right? That we should strive to create a society where one's opportunities, one's benefits, one's well-being do not depend on one's race, right? And if we can get people to understand that idea of colorblindness, I think that would be a worthy project.
Can I add to that?
Mm-hmm.
I just want to say that in order to think about color, to answer your question, I would suggest that we consider the construction of color blindness as a normative ideal, as a racial project in the Omi and Wanant sense. You know, a racial project that refers to the creation of racial meaning to construct an alternative framework through which material resources of the state are redistributed. So, when King advocates for color blindness in D.C. in 1963, he's advocating for the state to stop engaging in Jim Crow, right? When post-King, post-civil rights folks begin to advocate for color blindness as the new ideal, it's for a decidedly different type of racial project in the era of affirmative action to say that now let's be colorblind, now let's not prefer anyone according to race. So I just wanted to tie that to this concept of racial project.
Mm-hmm. Okay, other questions? In the middle, right here. There's a mic coming.
Sorry, my voice is going a little bit. I want to say, don't you think part of the danger of embracing this colorblindness is that we as Americans stop talking about race publicly? And I think I was born in England and I have a lot of family there. And when I moved to the US, a lot of my family members say, how racist is America? It's got to be crazy. Yet at the same time, you know, America is the first country in the Western world with a minority president, vice president, or secretary of the treasury, chancellor, exchequer, anyone in a major position, basically. In America, I think, although we have a lot of problems with race, we talk about them publicly. My fear is that if we embrace this idea of colorblindness, and that all that conversation goes to the background, and you get kind of this, let's all hug, but let's not face our problems. I mean, people in England in the race riots didn't really talk about race. They talked about it as class riots. When it's a Bangladeshi, a Pakistani kid, and a black kid, that strikes me as a race problem, not as a black and a white problem. And another thing I'd say is, this is a sort of secondary point, Professor Caldwell, you talked about putting a neutral framework on a biased sort of underlying society. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, we have that at the law school, and when that's what we're taught in the law school, and that's what we embrace, how can we, as people of color and activists in our society, change that? We have no model. You know, a lot of the kids of color here will be first-generation college students, first-generation graduate students, yet we come in to a totally neutral application from a biased framework. So how would you suggest that we change that in law school so that we have a model going forward in society?
Okay, so who wants to
put me
to
on
start?
The spot. I'll start. and you know I like spots, right? I'm going to start with a neutral application to begin with. and say as advocates for racial justice, just as Professor Banks indicates that there's more than one way to be colorblind or to think about colorblindness, there's more than one way to be neutral. And so you can be neutral toward racial justice or neutral away from racial justice. In other words, we don't have to be race conscious in the sense of affirmative action, picking one person over another person. We can have sort of targeted universal projects that really take account of both the race and class issues that exist in society. We can do that. We have done that in the past. Part of the thing we need to think about also is the relationship, the intersection between race and class. Can't pretend that one is that they're not constitutive of each other. That doesn't mean that we are going to prefer one group over the other group if we're race conscious, that we're preferring the poor people of color over poor whites. It means that we have to learn how to speak to each other in a language that understands class and race projects and find a way to converge interests across race. Now, part of the problem with that is even if we don't have the racism, as it were, defined by Professor Banks of the past, we have a lot of the leavings or some of the ideas. We haven't changed our minds in certain ways because there was enormous attempt by people seeking racial justice to come up with neutral class-based projects in the society, certainly in the 30s. And race was constituted in such a way that people thought they'd be stigmatized, other groups, white groups that had the same economic interests as African-Americans and other people of color, thought they'd be stigmatized if they described their economic interests in terms or along with groups that were subordinated by race. We need to get past that. We still have that problem. We still define the civil rights movement as an exclusive race-based movement, focused only on African Americans, not even thought about in terms of other groups of color, which of course was not the case. Y'all come, everybody was welcome. Anybody who wanted to show up could show up. The other thing we have to remember is that the anti-discrimination framework that we have is narrower than the aspirations of the civil rights movement. It was intellectually rich, and it focused substantially on class issues. We need to go back to those frameworks and figure out how to speak across those frameworks. So colorblindness, yes, I want us to speak about race. That's one of the problems with colorblindness and post-racialism. It's a conversation-stopping move. When you speak the word post-racial, let's not talk. We have to speak, and we have to learn to unearth some of the ways of thinking, if not acting, that still keep us from coming together.
Right up front. I know you want to respond. Hang on. Right up front, and then you can comment perhaps even after this.
Thank you, Professor. Some of my theories are inspired by people like Professor Lonnie Garnier and Scott Page from University of Michigan. Mm-hmm. He wrote a book called The Difference, mm-hmm. and he talks about diversity. And going back to some of the points that were highlighted, some of the things that I learned were that it's important for people to kind of like address these issues in terms of merit and bringing the country together and kind of like bringing the best out of people so that instead of just looking, for example, looking at standardized test scores as, okay, you know what, we're going to pick up the first three candidates, number one, number two, number three, it calls for us to look at merit and diversity in a different kind of way in the sense that your top candidate, your second candidate, and your third candidate may have the same strengths. So how about looking at number seven and number eight, who may have the strengths that number one and number two don't have? Secondly, the other issue that I wanted to highlight, Professor, and you brought it up, was who is responsible? And I, you know, after reading Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, she highlights certain Supreme Court rulings, and some of them are Terry versus Ohio, Florida versus Bostick, Schneckloth versus Robinette, and so forth. I mean, she really gives it a thorough treatment. And I think that the Supreme Court has really done disservice to this country. Because what the Supreme Court rulings have done for this country is that they have given the police a lot of discretionary power in the sense that if kids are hanging out in a neighborhood, the first thing that the cops are gonna do is look at the black kids, look at what they're doing. And as it is, statistical evidence really shows us that when it comes to drug sales and illegal drug use, it is across all races. So one thing that the Supreme Court has really messed up for us is this issue of, first of all, okaying racial discretionary practices by the police, number one, and then number two, acting as the foot soldiers for the executive. And then number three, we want to talk about the legislative process. And Professor, you spoke about the importance of engaging the masses, the bringing people together, and that was going to enable us to make change. Because if you go back to some of the laws that were passed by Clinton, that is the TANF, and how it affects people who've been incarcerated because of drugs, and how they get kicked out of public housing, they don't have welfare, and all these different things. So it's important for us to really mobilize, just in the same way that they did way back then in the civil rights movement and so forth. And then lastly, I wanted
to... It's going to have to be last.
Okay. Yeah. And lastly, I wanted to say that in terms of colorblindness, there's so many structural features of this country that still prevent people from getting up. So colorblindness to me is just a fiction.
Okay. So it's a great comment, and it actually brought up an issue that we touched on at the beginning but really didn't talk about, which is does the post-racial doctrine, the post-racial ideology, have an impact on how we address issues of race in the criminal justice system, issues of race in a courtroom setting? Mm-hmm. Does anybody want to play with that a little bit?
I wanted to start with courtroom setting. First, I want to establish myself as on the side of continuing to deal with courts. In other words, I know Professor Banks didn't say no courts, and I'm not saying that you did. There are some recent articles in the New York Times that indicate that we shouldn't seek racial justice through courts. I think courts are sites of cultural performance, and we need to continue to express ourselves and be conscious in terms of rights rhetoric. I don't abandon rights. I think it's important as a way of making policy. There are more than one way to make policy, more than one way to bring about social change. But I think access to courts is important. And one of the things that's happened to us with narrow interpretations of proof requirements in procedural rules, we have been denied access to justice. We better speak up about it. Access to courts is important. And how do you get access to courts? Vote. Privileged people, to many young people that I know, I've been here since the flood, Noah and all the students that I've taught, when I see them at alumni meetings, too many young people from this law school and other progressive young people, privileged, do not vote. Elections matter. They determine who sits on courts. So that's one a concern that I have. I wanted to just be sure that we think about that. The other problem we've got to think about is disparate impact liability. The Roberts Court's most post-racial decision is the Ricci decision, Ricci versus DiStefano, where it dealt a blow to disparate impact liability. And it prioritized disparate treatment, that is, proof of intent, over disparate impact. Now, when I say there's more than one way to be neutral, that is the greatest innovation in the second reconstruction, is the advent of disparate impact liability. Now, the blow struck by the court was in a Title VII decision, not a constitutional claim. The court decided in 1976 that disparate impact liability was inappropriate for proof of discrimination under the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. It left standing statutory liability. the blow struck by the Roberts Court to disparate impact liability to almost equate it or to affirmative action on the liability side, not on the remedy side, just on the liability side, struck a blow. The reason there's a blow is that lots of regulations, lots of statutes in the anti-discrimination regime use disparate impact liability, fair credit legislation, Title VI. All sorts of anti-discrimination laws look at disparate impact. What you're allowed to look at disparity. Look at a neutral rule and look at the disparity that's created by the neutral rule. And then ask whether or not, and if it has an impact on a subordinated racial group or gender group or other group protected by anti-discrimination law, we are asked to look for another way to be neutral that satisfies the business need of the employer or the government with less disparate impact. It allows us to search for best practices, and that's what's happened in the court, that we've dealt a blow to disparate impact liability. We need to fight for that. And let me just be clear about education. Title VII is the statute that courts, let me say this, courts look to Title VII developments when they look to disparate impact liability in other areas. The regulations under Title VI, a statute which affects education, permit the Department of Education and the Justice Department basically to bring suits and pursue disparate impact liability. We need that liability. Let me tell you why we need it. We've got in-school practices like tracking, like high-stakes testing, like disparate racial assignment to special education, like disparate racial assignment to racial treatment in respect to discipline that harm inside schools, and particularly integrated schools, the interests of Black and Latin children. These issues are extremely important because schools are the beginning of the pipeline to jail, school to prison pipeline. If you don't get an education, a good education, if you're put out of school for discipline purposes, there are collateral consequences already to the school discipline issues, not just to incarceration, but collateral consequences start in school. Disparate impact liability is extremely important. Now, we have an administration that's willing to take those cases to the court. Most administrations prior to this one haven't been willing to do that. But now we have a court that's hostile to disparate impact. I love neutrality, but there's all kinds of ways to be neutral. And we need to find one that works for the society, that works for everybody.
30 seconds on Scott Page. Go ahead. I just have a 30-second comment on the Scott Page reference, and he's doing really great research along the lines that you described, that studying corporate corporations, that diversity in employees actually yields better results because you have a wider range of norms that operate. And so he studied this as a scientist, said, I don't have any skin in this game. This is just what the data is. And what it made me think of, and I'll just throw this out there, I think that's absolutely correct. And you, law students know this, obviously, when you're interviewing too, and the difficulty is communicating this and to have employers grasp it. But the recent examples trigger to me why his research rings so true. I think about like the J.C. Dugard case, where there are multiple state authorities that actually went to the house of the pedophile and just let them be, didn't inspect the backyard. And it wasn't until they went to the Berkeley campus and it was two female police officers that noticed that there was something odd about this and these two poor girls who are not having eye contact and operating very strangely, right? And it wasn't until that moment that they actually captured him. It similarly makes me wonder during this whole Penn State horror, you know, what people are asking, if more women had been involved in that, or if more people of color had been involved outside of the kingdom of insular insiders, right? Might there have been a different result? So thank you for raising that.
Professor Cho, you alluded a little bit to comparison with...
Here comes a microphone.
Thank you. Professor Cho alluded a little bit to a comparison with especially the anti-immigration movement, but I was wondering to what extent, and this is also recognizing that some of the most systematic and pervasive sort of structural implementations of racism affect African Americans, but to what extent does the post-racial conversation or the colorblind conversation address other minority groups, Latinos, Asians, Southeast Asians, or Middle Eastern, people of Middle Eastern descent? And
who wants?
I have an answer, but
go ahead.
Go ahead.
I've been thinking about this a lot, and this is my take on it, because I actually, as I said earlier, think that post-racialism is a rather targeted type of racial project that's coming from a particular place, aimed at a particular place. And if it's coming from, in large part, liberals who would benefit Democratic Party, let's say, DNC operatives, I think the target is about limiting, silencing Black political subjectivity, collective Black political subjectivity of the more traditional noisy sort, not the sort of Obama iteration, that has, if you just look at voting data, you can see my colleague Terry Smith at DePaul is writing a book on this, but the white Democratic presidents or even Obama for that matter would not be elected but for the overwhelming support among Black voters coming out at 90%+, right? And so I think that this whole project is aimed at weakening that kind of expression. And to that extent, I think it's a different kind of racial project that's being directed at Latinos. So instead of attempting to defame and appropriate Blackness, as we're seeing through post-racialism, it's really a different sort of extermination valence, that you're seeing with Latinos, right? Because they're not seen as having that same type of moral capital historically established and built up over the decades. I'm not saying they don't have it. I'm saying it's not perceived in that way.
Okay. Actually, we have time for one more question from the room, and then we'll have a final comment on the panel. So right up here. Here comes the mic.
The discussion of post-racialism and colorblindness is focusing on the effects on people of color, but I'm wondering why it's ignored the impact of whiteness and race and class privilege and how we bring that into the discussion and in our work towards equality.
Single answer.
Do you want to answer?
I would say there's one answer. One of the answers is you should take Professor Cho's course, my course, Professor Banks' course, because we're not talking about white people. We're talking about the ideology of whiteness. So that when we talk about post-racialism and colorism and all that stuff, we include white people as a color group, a class is included. There's just so much, I like the focus on language because there's just so much we need to learn about language and how we use language and what the language around race means. It's extremely important that we do that. The other is, I wanted to say to the previous speaker, is to think of, sometimes we use race as a lens, which is a way, sort of Professor Lonnie Guinier at Harvard is noted for saying, sometimes the people at the bottom are African Americans or Latinos or some other subordinated group. The particular subordinated group at the time operate as canaries in the mine. They tell us that the society is sick. You send a canary to the mine and the canary doesn't come back. You know not to send the miners in. So we need to pay attention, even if we don't see Latinos or Middle Easterners at a particular moment as the target of post-racialism. Just wait. There's enough out there and it will eventually get to you if you're the other group. That's something, it's absolutely the case. And I think we're going to start thinking of seeing more of that with respect to all of the problems that we saw with terrorism, detention, those kinds of issues, racial profiling of various groups.
So we have all of 5 minutes, 4 minutes left. one of the questions that the organizers of this lunch asked if we would be willing to address is, as professors, what advice would you give to students who are encountering a silencing of discussions of race in the classroom and are displeased about that? What would you advise them to do to raise these issues and have these issues as part of the conversation in the classroom? So who would like to start? You haven't spoken for a minute. You get to go, Rick.
I'll take it. So let me just start by talking about the, in the classroom. The classroom is a wonderful setting, I think, to talk about racial issues. Because conversations in the classroom are different than a lot of the conversations we have in the political realm about race. A lot of the conversations we have in the political realm about race are, you know, about race sort of writ large, right? Race generally. And I think those conversations are conversations, at least, that are often not very productive. Witness President Clinton's conversation about race, right, which some of you may remember. And those conversations are often not very productive because they just devolve into one side trying to point out that someone else is racist, the other side trying to show that they're not racist, and there's this sort of back and forth. It's kind of like hide and seek with racism, right? And we want to try to figure out who's the real racist or who's not the racist. And that's not a productive conversation. The conversation you can have in the classroom is a conversation about the racial dimensions of concrete social problems, whether those problems relate to children in foster care or young people in a juvenile justice system or expulsion from school. There you're talking about racial problems in a concrete social setting, and that's a very useful conversation to have, because then the conversation can be not about who's the racist or who's not the racist. Instead, it can be a very pragmatically oriented conversation about how do we solve this social problem and what role might courts or other policymakers play in the process. So I think that's an approach that we should embrace, right? And I would hope that most faculty would embrace that approach, because many of the issues that you engage in the classroom do have racial dimensions, and those should be highlighted.
Sumi?
I'll just leave you with a quote from my friend and colleague, Frank Valdez, at the University of Miami. Mm-hmm. He has this great definition of law, which is very broad, and he says, law is everything that the state regulates and fails to regulate. Therefore, everything. And so therefore, I think that opens up for you the ability to bring any conversation into the classroom, into the legal education classroom. Mm-hmm. And it is legal, right? It's just whether or not your prof is creative enough to understand that.
And so if the professor is not creative enough to understand it, are there some things that we can do to sort of bring it to the fore?
Well, I think everybody in the room may not understand some aspects of the problem there, too. One is that there's always been a tension around students' desire to have discussions about race in courses, particularly courses that are not necessarily denominated as race, first-year courses especially. And then there's a general view on behalf of many faculty that those conversations are distracting, they take us away from the principal mission, which is to move the doctrine along and prepare people for exams. That tension is never going to go away, but I want to be clear that post-racialism, since young people are the target of post-racialism, according to Professor Cho, that there may be more tension. That is to say, more people who think we're post-racial, and a few that want to talk about the issue, and find more silencing. The only thing to do is keep bringing the issues up. You have to take a risk. Sometimes it may be that, maybe, I think probably what you could do, if your professor was Professor Taylor Thompson, she'd be willing to talk to you about the problem. She'd be willing to receive a set of questions from students about a particular area, so she'd be prepared to discuss the issue. In other words, first-year teachers can come together and talk about the issues with students, and we've done that before. I chair the diversity working group, and we've had that as a remedy. Here's my major concern, and I checked with Professor Cho, I didn't check with Professor Banks. students get the education they demand. Over the years that I've been here, so many courses have come into the curriculum because students petitioned us to teach those courses. Here's what happened immediately after the election. Those courses that are denominated race courses, or that are in doctrinal areas that deal specifically with race issues, employment, fair housing, voting, those precipitous decline in enrollment. Now, those courses are not going to stay around if you're not interested in them. So if you're interested in those courses, you don't have the tension that you have in the other courses. You get the education you say you want. It's on you.
And on that, please join me in thanking our panel. And can I ask if Aisha, I saw Pierce walk out, Yan, can you stand up? These were the folks who organized this. And you have 5 minutes to get to class, so go.